Welcome. For those who don't know, I'm Brian Walsh, on behalf of Mr. James Allen Davidson, or just Davo, as many of you affectionately knew him. I thank you for coming to this service today. This service is to commemorate Davo's life and acknowledge his impact and influence on ourselves and the community in general. The reason for the format of the funeral arrangements today is to reflect more closely the life and values of Mr. James Allen Davidson. We're here today to acknowledge the passing of Davo and extend our deepest sympathy to his family, especially to Lois, who has lost her husband, to Joanne and Warren, who have lost their father, but to all of you here who have lost a relative or a friend. It's appropriate at this time to read a small verse in memory of Davo. With tears we saw you suffer as we watched you fade away. Our hearts were almost broken as you fought so hard to stay. We knew you had to leave us, but you never went alone, for a part of us went with you the day you left your home. I don't think any of us is ever truly ready to say goodbye to a loved one, no matter how it happens, suddenly as a result of a single incident, or slowly as the result of age and illness, as it was for Davo. We wish we could have held on to him just a little bit longer. And even when we see death as a friend who brings an end to pain and suffering, there is still something within us that wishes it had all been a bad dream, that Davo had never taken ill and life could go back to normal. As Davo's family and friends, you'll probably understand what I mean when I say it's one of life's ironies, that even as we rejoice that Davo is now free of pain and is enjoying eternal life, we also long for him, healthy and well, with all his energy, back in this life. Our longings leave us tired and aching inside from grief. For there was so much more of life that Davo wanted to experience. He wanted so much to continue watching his children and grandchildren make their way in life. He wanted more Christmas dinners with family, more walks with a dog, more practice with his guitar, and more time to just fix things. In short, Davo wanted to live, to love, and continue to grow old, as we all expect to do so. And although he has physically left us, he will still be walking beside us in our memories and in our hearts. Or in the words of a poetic, although unknown author, "Come dry your tears and smile again. I'm only a whisper away. Near in the dusk of the evening, just out of sight in the day, watching you walking and sleeping, hearing each prayer that you pray. Sending my love to surround you. I'm only a whisper away. So come dry your tears and smile again. Remember the good times we've known. Cherish the joy we discovered and the love that was planted and grown. Your road may seem lonely ahead and distant horizons look grey, but you won't be walking alone because I'm only a whisper away." Each of us is here today because we've been touched in some way by Davo's life. We share something in common. We know what it's like to experience loss. We know what it feels like to hurt inside. Each of us deals with our grief in our own way. There is no right way to deal with the death of a loved one. There is no time limit placed on how long we grieve. Coming to terms is a solitary, personal experience, but it need not be a journey we make alone. No matter how hard we try to cope on our own, there'll be times we need to talk to others. There'll be times when we need to know that someone else understands. Times when we need the encouragement of a voice behind us, reminding us that what we're feeling is okay, telling us we're loved, encouraging us so we can deal with our own emotions. In this way, it is my sincere hope that all of you here make a continuing effort to support those closest to Davo. Whether you call in to share a cup of tea or coffee, invite them to an event, or just send a birthday or Christmas card, these acts of friendship will tell them that people care about them, that they are loved, and it will help them recover from the loss of Davo. The memories of Davo you have as a relative or a friend will always be there, and there would be no sorrow in your hearts today if yesterday you had not known the pleasure of Davo's presence in your life. And I would now like to ask Charlotte Fleming, one of Davo's great-granddaughters, to step forward and read a verse in memory of him.
Though you were not but just one man, it mattered not, you had a plan. Whether as a father, granddad, son, you were always kind to everyone. The memories that we made together will live within our hearts forever. The jokes, the tears, the laughter too, we always smile when thinking of you. It's sad, we know, but now you're gone, the legacy you've left definitely lives on. So as granddad, father, son or whatever, we always recall and forget you never.
Thank you, Charlotte. And now I ask Peter Fowles to step forward, who's a nephew of Davo, to read the eulogy.
We're all here to celebrate the life of James Allen Davidson, fondly known as Davo. He was born on the 1st of May 1934 in Cheadle, Cheshire, England, and was the youngest of five children to Bert and Maud Davidson. Davo would often tell stories of his childhood days and how, as he put it, he was a bugger of a kid. A couple of instances come to mind, one of which was being told to bury his dead pet rabbit, so he buried it, with its head sticking out of the ground. Another was not being told to touch the small case that was called the Box of Things. This contained Bert's many war mementos and was placed high on a shelf, well out of reach of Davo and the other kids. Of course, Davo climbed up and got down the Box of Things and was giving a bit of a hiding for doing so. When Davo was 17, his brother Fred, who came to Australia some years earlier, contacted his father saying, you'd better send the young bloke over. So Davo was put on a ship, along with two other mates, Bert Sherritt and Dennis Holland, and they arrived in Sydney in 1952 on Davo's 18th birthday. Quite young to be travelling the world. Bert and Dennis came over in the Little Brother Movement, as it was called back then, and in those days, Davo was classed as a 10-pound pom. He spent time up in Queensland with Fred, where he completed his national service, and then travelled down to Logie Bray area of Finlay, where Dennis Holland found him some work with a man named Jack Armstrong and his father, who had owned a garage near the general store. Funny how in much later years, his daughter Joanne would live on the farm just down the road. Davo continued working for Jack Armstrong, who by this time had moved into Finlay, and also working in the same area was his lifelong friend, Les McClelland. Les and Davo both lodged at the home of Mr. and Mrs. Fred Walsh, and Davo also commented that Mrs. Walsh was a great cook. The two of them not only worked and lived together, but would attend the local dances, which in those days were held quite frequently during the week, in all the local towns, some as far as Oakland's. Off they would go with Les strapped into Davo's beloved Triumph motorbike nearly every night till the early hours to whichever town had the dance on, come rain, hail or shine. They earned themselves quite a reputation for having two to three helpings of desserts at the dance suppers, and a trait that Davo kept up later on in his life. Les recalls the time both of them decided to go on holidays to Queensland. They only had 2 weeks holidays back then, so they borrowed another mate's ute and off they went, catching up with Davo's brother Fred at Inglewood and camping in the river there. On the return, just near Dubbo, they had ute trouble and a broken spring in the ute. So they bought a new spring. They didn't have any money to have anyone fix it, so they found a clearing along the road, and both of them, using whatever they could find, blocks of wood, etc., fixed the spring themselves. They finally made it back to Finlay, thought they'd better count how much money they had left after their adventure, and Davo reckons they had 45 cents between the two of them, 5 shillings in those days. Those were the good old days. Both of them remained great friends, and Les fondly calls Davo Crockett. Soon after, Davo met a young Maroopna nurse, Lois McKinley, of the McKinley clan of Barooga. He gave Lois a lift to Maroopna from Melbourne, but this time not on his motorbike. The two were soon an item and became engaged while Lois was nursing in Melbourne. Davo, being the young lad that he was, turned up in Melbourne to help pick out the engagement ring, dressed in trousers and a white Bond singlet. Quite a fashion statement. Lois promptly marched him across the road to Myer, where they bought him a shirt. They married on the 28th of October in 1961, and their firstborn, Joanne, was born exactly 12 months after their wedding. Warren followed 2 years later in July 1964. By this time, Davo had worked for Jack Armstrong for about 10 years, and when he got the bug that he could start a business of his own. Davo and Lois borrowed money from Lois's parents, Ern and Gurley McKinley, and in 1965, Davidson's Engineering was born. Davo spent his early years in business underneath small balers on Cocky's farms with the help of Alan Muscles Gray, then employed his first full-time employee, Ross Whittaker, in 1969, followed closely by Darrell Hams and Russell Miller. Davo had to expand his workshop due to some trusses he was building for the newly constructed chemist sticking out of the windows of the current building, so he had to upgrade to accommodate those. Business then grew to other agricultural equipment for livestock and grain handling, which evolved into the iconic Davo ferry bin. I can even remember those back in the day. Over 250 of these bins were eventually made, and Lois complemented the business by running the books, quite tightly, I believe. During the expansion years, Lois and Davo had the desire to employ apprentices, but because Davo was never actually qualified in a trade, as many weren't in those days, they had a lot of red tape to cut through. They were finally granted approval, which also allowed other businesses in the region to follow suit. Davo's son Warren was one of those apprentices, and he still uses these skills today. The Davidson enjoyed success in business, venturing into more diverse range of structural steel fabrications, ute trays, giant rice mill hoppers, design and erection of farm machinery and sheds. One of those sheds stands at the showgrounds at Finlay. It was originally a cattle pavilion, but has now moved on to house indoor cricket and now is the main pavilion. Davo had to design a jib, which he put on the back of his ute to install the trusses and the purlins. In today's standards, this would probably not have passed the pub test, but it did the job back then. After many successful years and expanding the building 3 times, the Davidsons decided to close down the engineering business and in the mid-80s bought a building in the main street of Finlay where they concentrated on plant and party hire. Soon, there was a third generation that came along. One story that comes to mind was when his first grandchild, Matt, maybe 3 to 4 years old, would burst into the hire shop yelling, "Where's Grandad?" and then make a beeline straight for Davo's pride and joy, the Dynabolt display. Matt loved to play with these and would also always switch the different sizes around in the display. And if you knew Davo, he always had to go and correct that and put them all back in the correct order once Matt was gone. He would religiously put them back in order. Another was when he was little sister Anthea, who was around 8 years old, asked Granddad to fix her plastic sunglasses. He did this with super glue, and unbeknownst to him, they were never the same again. This was a rare occurrence. The final grandchild, Jade, arrived 7 years later, whom Davo aptly named Squirt. Davo idolised all his 3 of his grandchildren, and they knew if they had anything broken, just take it to Granddad. He'll fix it, and he usually did. At this time, Davo got his first dog, Muffin, who always escaped and ended up at the hire shop. After many happy years, sadly, Muffin passed away. Lois decided Davo needed a new friend and came along with Rick the collie dog. We remember the day when Rick got lost. Poor Davo couldn't find Ricky Bones, as he was affectionately called, so Davo jumped in his ute and started to search the streets of Barooga for Rick, calling out his name, driving past his home in Banker Street many times. Lois, recalling it, she saw him go back and forth but didn't understand what he was doing. She didn't really know that. The dog had got lost. So finally Davo stopped the ute and asked a woman that was walking by, "Have you seen a collie dog by any chance?" The woman looked puzzled and then pointed to the back of the ute and said, "You don't mean the one in the back of your ute, do you?" Poor Davo must have been a bit embarrassed, but we reckon Rick would have loved it. During his retirement, Davo often helped on the Fleming farm for many years, even constructing their new kid home. There wasn't much that Davo hadn't touched in one way or another on that farm. Funny thing though, Davo always seemed to be in need of just a cupful of fuel whenever he came out. And when he asked Greg for some, Greg would always say, "Well, Davo, I'll go get the cup." On the other hand, when the job was done, Greg would always say, "Thanks, Davo," and Davo would reply, "Well, I can't bank thanks." Davo and Lois ventured over to Perth a few times to visit Warren and Wendy and Jade, and when he did so, he promptly asked for jobs to do around the house, as he couldn't sit still and just have a holiday without doing something. They managed to go over to England both in 1981 and 1985, where he was reunited with his eldest sister, Edna. His father, Bert, and mother, Maud, emigrated to Australia with his sisters, Peggy and Eileen. In the years following their arrival in Australia, both parents passed and are buried in the Cobram East Cemetery. He has only one living sibling, Eileen, in Queensland. Davo was self-taught in guitar, loved music, wood turning, and his family, especially when his great-grandkids came along, Charlotte, Savannah and Xander. In later years, the great-grannies would love to take turns to roar around Granddad's scooter or pick oranges from the tree when visiting. Davo was a very clever, innovative man who nutted out the problem, drew a sketch of the solution and would come up with a near-perfect result. Davo spent his remaining years in Barooga with the love of his life, Lois, before entering care in November 2022. He was so greatly loved and will be sorely missed. So where will we take our broken stuff now? Rest in peace, Davo.
Thank you, Peter. I've now asked Jade Davidson and Anthony Aboys, two of Davo's great-granddaughters, to step forward.
To the world, he was our granddad, but to us, he was the world. Granddad was always kind-hearted and caring person and would always put others before himself. He was a true gentleman at heart. He was a man of very few words, however, never failed to show you how proud he was. He always watched our school sports and swimming and cheered us on from the sidelines, no matter what. He always asked how our day was and loved to listen to our stories, even when he didn't quite understand what we were talking about. He had a smile that could light up the room and a cheeky grin when he was up to no good. He often took me for a bike ride around the lake before dinner, and before we started would open the glove box, which was always fully stocked with chocolate eclairs. There were strict instructions not to tell Nanny, so I would eat all my dinner when we returned. He never sent a plate back empty and never missed an opportunity to have sweets. The granddad special was always peaches and ice cream. After sweets, you would hear the guitar and a voice coming from the lounge room. There was never an evening where he didn't play. He had a beautiful voice and played the guitar with such ease. Part of me thinks he should have been a musician. With his guitar, his dog and shed, he was unstoppable. When saying goodbye, he always told me, "Be good, and if you can't be good, be safe." I'm not sure what part driving down the street after he had his license taken off of him or tipping his mobility scooter was good or safe, but nevertheless, he did it anyway. He told me the scooter flipped because of uneven surfaces, but we all know that he was travelling way too fast and took the corner way too quick. As an engineer, he had a mind like no other. He always seeked to find how things worked. He would pull things apart, put them back together, and in my lifetime, there was never a job that Granddad couldn't do. He fixed everything, and if he didn't know how then and then how to fix, he would always find a way. I once made him a bowl in woodwork, and I gave it to him as a gift. He said, "I'll fix it up for you." I thought it was already finished, but I guess it wasn't up to Granddad's standards. That bowl is now fully varnished with a lid and definitely looks better than when I made it. Granddad leaves behind a legacy in us all that will continue to be passed down the generation as the family grows. If you ever encounter a problem or obstacle, just think, what would Granddad do? He could always make the impossible possible. He was a jack of all trades and a master of one, and that was being our granddad.
I've got two speeches here today. One's from Mum. She would be up here, but she's a bit of a sook. Joke's on her. I take after her. Hey, Daddy-o. Just thought about a couple of things that made me smile. Remember the time that you were looking for another project to do? We decided to embark on a rustic-looking piece of furniture that I wanted made. We all know that rustic wasn't your thing, but in the end we finally convinced you not to sand it or stain it or polish it. And I know it was quite out of your comfort zone. But in the end, the finished project turned out great. We all loved your sayings, whenever you forgot something. You know, that thingamajig, or that doovalacky, or the whatchamacallit, or the what's it. And when it all worked out in the end, then that was more better. I told you, Mum. And these are my words. Whenever Mum and Dad wanted to get rid of me for the school holidays, Grandad and Nanny would load us up in the car and take us for adventures in Bright. Some of my fondest memories were of Grandad, the long walks along the Ovens River, where he would take me on some very questionable bridges. One of them was named the Swingy Bridge. Even the dog was a bit nervous. The trails around Bright were long, windy and steep, but Grandad, being the fit man that he always was, never seemed bothered. I'm not sure if Grandad was trying to exhaust me or the dog, but it worked. I'm pretty sure I always slept well after one of our nature walks. Nanny and Grandad then bought a caravan in Port Punca, which we soon named the Punca Patch. And in a collaborative effort, we made a wooden sign together to display in the front. And then he would invite me to play snooker in the communal area and absolutely obliterate me. No mercy. You were one of the kindest and most clever human beings I've ever met. Your mind was always ticking over with innovation. You're a fantastic role model, and I love you, Grandad.
Grandad, my childhood with you as my granddad was everything I could have asked for. The memories of our trips to Bright, riding our push bikes, sometimes riding them backwards as Grandad used to do, throwing the rods in at the lake, me endlessly looking over your shoulder whilst you fix things. As I grew older, I would always ask you to show me how to fix things. You always showed me the way because you could fix anything, and if I ever needed to know where you were, I would be silent and listen for your whistle, as you did so well. I knew exactly which direction to go. You always had time for me, which is something I will always cherish forever. Your patience, your kindness, and always being there if I needed you. Thank you for being my granddad, and I promise to clean the shed.
Thank you for those words. And I would now ask Savannah and Xander Fleming to step forward, who are actually great-grandchildren, not like my mistake before, to read a verse in memory of their pop.
Don't think of him as gone away. His journey has just begun. Life holds so many facets, this earth is only one. Just think of him as resting from the sorrows and tears in place of the warmth and comfort where there are no days and years.
Think how we must be wishing that we could know today how nothing but our sadness can really pass away. And think of him as living in the hearts of those he touched for nothing. Loved is ever lost, and he was loved so much.
Well done. We've heard the story in words of, I knew him as Alan, but Davo's life, and now we'll see some of the pictures of his life and wind your minds back to your own memories of Davo as we watch a slideshow. there. And I know half the people in this room would have helped to build that photo of the green grain ferry bin. I'm sure you could build it in your sleep, half the people in this room. There were some wonderful memories. But what we must remember today is that we're here today, not because Davo has died, but because he has lived. And during his time on earth, he shared his life with us. And although his life has been ended, it has been filled with love, laughter, and adventure. For today, we lift up our hearts in gratitude for the life of Davo, for all the kindness he displayed during his life, for all that he was to those who loved him, and for everything in his life that reflected goodness and love. May we rejoice in Davo's life, be thankful that his life touched ours. Surround us and all that mourn today with continuing compassion. Do not let grief be without end or overwhelm us, but rather draw us closer together in friendship and love. And now we come to the end, remembering that death is not extinguishing the light, it is only putting out the lamp because the dawn has come. We are grateful for the life that Davo has lived and for all that his life has meant to us. But it is now time to take our leave of Davo, whom we'll always remember with great warmth and appreciation. We return to our daily lives, resolved to follow his example of courage and sharing, to live our lives more fully with the same integrity and purpose, cheerfulness and love. From the midst of our proud mourning, we leave this service knowing that love is never changed by death, that nothing is ever lost by death, and the end is the harvest of a new beginning. So let us now commend Davo to God, our Heavenly Father, who has given us life and by his loving kindness has bestowed upon us new life. We commend to your merciful keeping Davo, our brother here departed. Davo, you'll be forever in the memories of all who knew and loved you. And it is with his final goodbye to you that all of us here say, we will remember you until we meet again. Now, very shortly, I'll ask the casket bearers to step forward to carry Davo to the hearse in preparation for his final journey to the Barooga Cemetery. But before I do, I'll say the final farewell. And so we say, we are glad he lived. We are glad we saw his face, felt his touch and heard his laughter. We are comforted to know all pain has ended and his spirit is free. And if the casket bearers could step forward, please.
Song that I love when music changes, so we can't believe it's leaving us here.